If you're joining us online, welcome. We're so glad that you chose to be with us today. If you didn't hear Danielle's announcement, all of this wonderful decoration is for our VBS this week. So we are having our first vacation Bible school during the week in our new building, Tuesday through Friday. So somebody ought to get excited about that. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, I'm so excited to start our new series this week called Armor Up. Everybody say Armor Up. We're going to take a fresh look at the armor of God, which most believers, if you've been saved very long, you've heard of the armor of God. You know about it, but if we're honest, most people aren't wearing theirs every day. They're not using it every day. And I think it's appropriate that we begin this series on our American Independence Day. On this week, or on the Independence Day weekend, this is the weekend we celebrate our freedom from the tyranny that was Britain. And for all my British friends watching online, we love you, but we still booted you out. And now you have to forgive us. If you're a Christian. Anyway. But as believers, we have a different kind of independence. We have a declaration of independence from the tyranny of the devil and the kingdom of darkness. And it was bought and paid for with the blood of Jesus Christ. Actually, Jesus' blood signed your declaration of independence. We could say metaphorically that our declaration of independence was signed by our forefathers in the blood that many of them shed. But our Christian Declaration of Independence was signed by Jesus. However, just like we take our national freedom that was won in the Revolutionary War, legally paid for, many of us understand that that's how we got it, but it has to be kept. It's got to be defended over and over and over, and really our nation has had to defend those freedoms again and again and again. And by the way, although this is our Independence Day weekend, I always use any excuse to thank the men and women that have and are and will serve in the military, because they're fighting today to defend our freedoms every day. But just like that's the case nationally, it's true spiritually. Jesus paid for our freedom. He bled and died for our independence from the tyranny of the devil. But every day, we got to defend that freedom. We got to walk in it. We got to stand in it. Because the enemy wants to take it back from you, even though legally he has no right to. He still tries. I saw a great quote on the armor of God on Twitter from a pastor friend of mine in England named James Prentice. He said, "The armor of God," which you'll notice the British spelling, because I copied it and pasted it directly from Twitter. "The armor of God is heavenly protection for every enemy attack we encounter. But it's still up to us to make that daily choice to put it on." The armor of God's our heavenly protection, but it's against any attack. There's no attack you'll ever have that the devil can bring that you don't have protection against, but it's still up to us to put the armor on every day. And that sums up the major theme of this series, is to armor up daily. Everybody say daily. To take up the armor of God like Paul told us to, in the book of Ephesians. Now, Ephesians is my favorite book of the Bible. I love Ephesians. Hooperman was birthed out of Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, but I love all of the book of Ephesians. And Paul ends this book with a strong admonition, really a command on how for them to live the rest of their lives. So as he's finishing his letter to the church at Ephesus, which Chris and I just went to Ephesus and walked down those ancient streets, and it was surreal to me. And he says, this is how you should live today and every day. So how many of you think it would be a good idea for us to hear what Paul had to say to them and take that command for ourselves? So let's begin in Ephesians 6. Let's begin in verse 10 and 11. He said, finally, my brothers, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, it's easy to read this because if you grew up in Sunday school, you studied the armor of God. Every Sunday school class studied the armor of God. If you grew up in church, you know about the armor of God. If you've been to church very well, you've heard somebody talk about the armor of God. So it's easy to read this something like your Sunday school teacher might have read it, especially if she was older. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles. If you heard somebody preach it, wiles of the devil. It's easy to read it that way. Now, finally, brothers. No, Paul's not saying it like that. Every word Paul uses, he chooses carefully. And everyone is dripping with meaning and revelation, but sometimes in the translation, we lose it, or even in the repetition or the familiarity, we miss it. So I want to go through these words quickly. Now, I'm going to have to fly through some of them to get to where we want to go today, but stay with me. I promise it's going to be worth it. He starts out and he says, finally. The Greek word finally is loipos, and it means from here forward. He's not saying finally. You know, like when a preacher says finally. It's not like that. You know, when somebody's preaching and they say, finally, I want to break. He's not saying the last point I want to make. What he's saying is, from given everything I've told you, from here on out, I want you to do something. From now on, this is how you're going to live. This is a command on how I want you to carry forward every day. He's saying, so from now on, I want you to do something. And what is he saying do? Be strong. Everybody say, be strong. The word be strong, or the phrase be strong, is endunameo, which means to endue with supernatural strength, ability, or power. It's a compound word, en, which means in, and dunamis, which means dynamite power or explosive power. It's where we get the English word dynamite. I talked about it last week. So here this verb is in the passive voice, so it means you don't do anything to get it. He's saying, I want you to receive strength. But not just any kind of strength. I want you to receive the dynamite, explosive power of God. This word would have been used in Greek mythology of demigods that would be injected with power from a god in Greek mythology. So when Paul uses this phrase, everybody there knows he's talking about like Hercules. How Hercules was infused in their Greek mythology with power from his God. And here Paul is saying, it's like that, but it's only different because he's saying, be infused with superhuman strength in the Lord. So not in some Greek mythology, not becoming a demigod, but by taking on the very character and power and explosive power of the living God. Are you here? He says, be strong finally from now on. From this day forward, from this moment forward, be strong in the Lord. In the Lord is locative, or it indicates where this superhuman strength is infused from. See, you're in him and he's in you. And if you study the book of Ephesians, it's all about being in Christ. Everybody say in Christ. It's location, location, location. So Paul is reminding them one more time, you're in Christ, and if you're in Christ, then Christ is in you. It's like when you wash dishes, when the, well, you've heard me use this example before, when the dish gets in the water gets in the dish is in the water, the water's in the dish. You take a poker and put it in the poker gets in the fire, then the fire gets in the poker. One's in the other, and the other's in the one. And so when you're in Christ, you get in Christ, and he's in you. And Paul's saying, put on, he's saying, be strengthened, be infused, be injected with power that comes from God. Then he says, being continually infused with superhuman strength, and, everybody say and, in the power. This word power is kratos. It's dominion. It's outward manifestation of power. It's power that's demonstrated. So he's saying, I want you to be infused with superhuman strength, but not just let it stay in there. Get it out. Demonstrate it. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cast out devils. Do the stuff. Are you starting to get the idea? Paul's saying, I want this supernatural power to be demonstrated in your life. I don't only want you to possess dynamite, I want you to blow up. I want you to explode with it. Then he says, the kratos, the dominion, the power of his might. This word might is ishkus, which is present but may remain active until needed, or muscle. Is Jason Ramirez here? Jason, where's Jason? Where's Jason? Hurry, come here, Jason. Come. Hurry. That's not hurrying. Come on now. Hurry. Now, Jason has some muscles. The reality is, Jason and I have the same amount of muscles. He ain't got no muscles I don't really have. His are just developed different than mine. Come on, you ain't gonna hurt my feelings. It's the truth. So this word, Paul is saying, I want you to understand that you have been, he said, from now on, every day, every minute, every second, realize you have been infused with superhuman strength. Not only is it in you, but I want you to always remember and let it come out and be explosive in the explosive power of the muscle that's available in God. So flex your muscles just for a minute. Come on, Jason. Flex it. See, if I do that, it ain't gonna look like that. Thank you, Jason. Come on, give me my hand. I wasn't going to let him take his shirt off, though, because it had gone downhill right there. Some of you went, whoa. I'm going to let him do that. But anyway, you get the idea. Just like Jason has muscles, how many of you know God has some muscle, baby? He's got some stored up power. But listen, if Jason's wearing a long sleeve baggy shirt, you can't see his muscles, but baby, they're still there. And whenever he needs to use them, he can flex those muscles and make something happen. Do you know that God has power that you may not know it day one, day two, day three, but when God flexes his muscle, when he takes his power in the earth, something happens. It's like a military buildup of power. It's the power to do battle when necessary. Just like an army builds up its troops, getting ready for a battle. One lady used to say it this way, it's bulldozer breath. I love that. Are you getting the idea? Now this sentence begins in the present passive imperative tense. Some of you go, I didn't know I was going to Greek class today. Well, welcome to my Greek class. Greek has many tenses. This one's present. It's now and it always will be. So this power is available now. It was available when Paul wrote it and he said now. And it was available next week when people read it and Paul said now. And it's available today when I just read it, it's now. And whenever you need it, it's available again. It's always present. It's passive. You receive it. You can't make it happen yourself. It's not about you. Come on, are you here? It's not your strength. It's his strength. You just receive it. And it's imperative. It's not a suggestion. Paul wasn't saying, when you feel like it, when it's convenient, he's saying, I'm commanding you. Be strong. Be being filled with the superhuman strength of God every day. He's saying it this way. Here's my paraphrase. From now on, be constantly growing in superhuman in your strength. Let me say that again. From now on, be constantly growing superhuman in your strength in the Lord and in the outward manifestation of the divine muscle that is inherent in him. That sounds like something I'm interested in. How about you? Then he tells us how to do it. He says you do that by putting on, verse 11, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The phrase put on there in Greek is enduo. It means to dress oneself, to hide, to in, or to clothe. So he's saying clothe yourself in the armor of God. Hide in it. Wrap yourself in it. This is your part. When you receive this power, he's saying you got to put this on. So when you put on, watch this, this suit of armor, this is your Iron Man suit. Tony Stark is just another dude until he puts on his Iron Man suit. Come on, are you here? Paul's saying, if Paul was writing this now, he would say, put on your Holy Ghost Iron Man suit. He's saying that when you wear this, you access the superhuman power of a living God. Without it, you're just another guy. You're another dude or dudette. But with it, you're a superhero. Or better yet, I would say you're a hooper hero. So he's saying, I'm commanding you to put this on every day. Then he says, the whole armor of God. The word whole is panoplia. It means all the weapons. Everybody say all the weapons. Danielle would say all the things. Put on all the things. See, this word is made up of pos, whole, and hoplon in Greek, which is weapons. So he's saying, be fully armored, completely armored. There was a picture. Paul would have understood the picture of a Roman soldier because, number one, there's a lot of reasons. One, he was a Roman citizen. But also, he spent so much time in jail, he was literally chained to him all the time. So Paul would look at them and make this spiritual analogy, but he probably began to realize that the toughest dudes always stayed fully armored. They knew how to armor up and stay up. Their armor had seven pieces, seven being the number of completion, a belt, a shield, a sword, a lance, a helmet, greaves, and a breastplate. Over this series, we'll go through all of them, but Paul is saying this. If you want all the superhuman strength, you got to wear all the weapons. If you're missing one piece of armor, you're still vulnerable to the devil to kill you. And there's a lot of Christians that wonder why they're being defeated over and over and over and over because they say, you know, I'm really good at this salvation thing, but they don't know how to use a sword. Or they say, I'm really good at speaking the word, but they don't walk in peace. Or they say, you know, I'm really good at walking in peace, but they don't know how to use it. Come on, are you here? And Paul's saying, take every bit of it. Somebody say all of it. Take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able. This word able is derived from that word for power in the Greek, dunamis. Dunamis, dynamite. He's not saying, so that put on the armor of God so that you might possibly be able to think about standing. No. He's saying, put on the armor of God so that you can stand. You're going to be able, you're going to have enough power to stand. The word stand in the Greek is histemi. It's a soldier's expression used for standing one's ground rather than taking flight. See, you got to decide, are you going to fight or are you going to flight? Too many Christians are fleeing, not fighting. So he's using this soldier's analogy. Be able to stand against. Against in the Greek is pros. It denotes a forward position or a face-to-face encounter. Come here, Cody. Come quickly. He's saying, I want you to put on the whole armor of God so that you can face the enemy. Eye to eye, toe to toe, not like this, not trying to dodge him, huh? There's too many Christians trying to dodge the devil. You need to learn to fight.
Yeah.
You can sit down. No retreat, no fear. He wanted to bow up so bad, you know he did. You know he did. Everything in him wanted to go. But I got my bluff in on him, or he's just didn't want to mess up my message. Anyway, probably the latter. No fear, no intimidation, so that you're able to go toe-to-toe, hand-to-hand, eye-to-eye against the wiles. The word, isn't that a great word? The wiles of the devil. Just sounds bad, doesn't it? The wiles. It's methodia, and it's the cunning art, deceit, craft, trickery. It's where we get the word method. It's a way of doing things deceitfully, a systematic way. It implies an order or logical arrangement, especially in steps. It comes from the root of this word is a road that you travel down. So the enemy has roads he travels down. He has a place he heads, and it's in your head. The devil is a one-trick pony. All he has is deceit, trickery, and lies. Are you with me? If he can, watch this, if he can get you to believe a lie, he can whip your hand. He's got you defeated. If he can get in any area that he can get you to believe a lie, he's got you defeated. So here's my paraphrase of this verse. Clothe yourself daily in the full armor of God. Don't miss a piece. To the end that you will be able to hold your ground, stand, go toe-to-toe against the methods, the strategies, and the tricks of the devil. Verse 12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Now Paul's explaining why we need this spiritual armor. We need it because we wrestle. The word wrestle in Greek is pale. It's a contest between two, watch this, in which each endeavors to throw the other, and which is decided when the victor is able to press and hold down his prostrate opponent, namely, hold him down with his hand on his neck. Cody is sitting there going, he's going to demonstrate this, isn't he? But I'm not. See, when we talk about wrestling, we're not Paul's not talking about your schoolboy fight on the playground. This isn't WWF or WWE or whatever it is, the World Wrestling Federation. This isn't fake wrestling. This is the real deal. And in Greek and Roman times, they had a palestra. It was they had a grand theater or a coliseum where they would do the games that they would have with the gladiator games. But they had a different place where they actually had spas. And they had steam baths and all of the, they had a whole spa system that was incredible. We just went and saw it when we were there. But then around there, they would have a palestra, which was like a gym. And in the gym, they would have sporting contests. And there were three kinds of contestants. First were boxers, but their boxers weren't like our boxers. Their boxers put shards of metal on their gloves so that when they hit you in the face, it cuts your face open. They had to wear metal helmets so that the shards only ripped their body, not their face. Then they had wrestlers, but wrestlers would fight one another, go toe-to-toe, but anything goes. They would break bones. One of their classic moves was to pick a guy up, throw him in the air, bring him down, and literally break his vertebrae. You've seen it in WWF, but they didn't really do it. They would break his vertebrae so that he couldn't move, paralyze him. If you didn't die, but you lost, many times they would gouge your eyes out so you couldn't see because you were not a worthy opponent. Do you understand the kind of bloody wrestling we're talking about? Then they had pancratists, which would go into the palestra. Pancratists was an anything goes. These guys made mixed martial arts and cage fighting look like a Sunday school disagreement. They would bite, kick, stab, hide weapons. I mean, these guys did it all. So the Ephesians knew exactly what Paul was saying when he's saying, when we go to the palestra of the Spirit, anything goes. The devil's going to cheat. He's not going to play fair. And he's going to kill you if you're not armored up. Somebody say armor up. Then he puts, I got to do this quickly, the enemy into four categories. First of all is principalities. That's arche in the Greek. It's first things or ancient rulers. There are spiritual forces that have been around a while. There are forces that have been around in your family for generations. Some of you, for 10 generations, there have been alcoholics. Some of you, you know, your granny was a fighter. Your great-granny was mean. She's meaner than snot. And your great-great-granny was bitter all the time. It's principal things. Huh? There are patterns in families that pass down, and there are demonic forces that have ruled over your family. And Paul's saying, you got to learn how to fight principal things. Because you could be the first one to break the power. Are you here? You could be the first one to get set free from it. You could be the first one not to get a divorce. You could be the first one to stay married. You could be the first one to serve God. You could be the first one to go to college. You could be the first one to not get offended and split churches every day. You could be the first. See, some people wear their devils like a badge. Well, you don't understand. We just got a bad temper in my family. Bless God, we've been mad at everybody for 100 years. Well, stop it. Not only are there individual principle things, there are principle things over regions. When we came into Denton, we started doing history. You know why? Because we wanted to find out some things. You know what we found out? That Denton's a very racially divided city. So we decided, we knew that's not kingdom, so we're going for all ages, all races, all kinds. We're going to serve one another, and you're going to have white people, black people, Hispanic people, Asian people. We're going to have every tribe and every tongue worshiping God, getting along, serving one another, because we're going to break the back of principle things. I could go on and on and on. Are you getting it? Are you getting it? So first he says there's principle things. Then he goes on and he says there's powers, which while they put that up, let me just say this, that principle things, you deal with those in LTS. If you're not in LTS, get in it, because we'll teach you how to deal with the principle things in your family and in your life. Then powers, that's word is authority, exousia. It's usually delegated authority. So there are forces the devil delegates to have dominion in your life, but Jesus took it back. And now it's a matter of who's going to exercise God's rule in the earth. I talked about that last week. And then he says rulers of the darkness of this age. In Greek, that's cosmo kratos, not cosmo kramer, cosmo Kratos. For Seinfeld people, that was a joke. This is world rulers of darkness in a given period of time. It's two words, cosmos, which is atmosphere, kratos, which is power and demonstration. We've talked about it before. So it's the demonstration of power in the atmosphere. It's a spiritual wickedness that's ruling in a region. It's spiritual, but it can be in earthly rulers who are controlled by demonic forces. Do you know that just like a spiritual leader in church can be controlled by the Holy Spirit, political and national rulers can be led by God's spirit or by demonic spirits. And so he's saying this is how you fight that. You're not fighting the person, you're fighting the spirit controlling the person. And listen, there are Republicans and Democrats and independents that are all, there are some in all of those categories that are being led by the spirit, and there's plenty that are being led by the devil. It's not about a political persuasion, it's about rulers that are controlling. See, Nero, when Paul's writing this, Nero was lighting Christians like tiki torches to have banquets in his honor. How many of you know that's a world ruler being ruled by darkness? Anyway, I got to keep moving. Everybody doing all right? Spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. That spiritual evil in realms above or outside the earth. Not heavenly as in where God and angels are, but outside the earth or the earth's atmosphere. This word can also mean things that are elevated. Hence, some translations say high places. So remember, the primary battlefield is in your mind. So whenever the devil gets you to exalt something above the truth of the Word of God, whenever he gets you to believe a lie, he is controlling you from a high place. See, people say we got to go up to the highest mountain and cast the devil down. And there's people that do that. They climb up mountains so they can get to the highest geographical point and deal with spiritual wickedness in high places. That is mental aerobics. Does no good. If you want to go up to the high places, crawl up in your brain where you don't believe God, don't trust God, don't live by faith. Cast that down. As I said, the devil's a one-trick pony and he wants to deceive you in your mind. So when you exalt anything above the Word of God, that's spiritual wickedness in a high place. Now I got to keep going. Look at verse 13. Therefore, take up the whole armor. He says it again, the whole armor, not part of it, all of it. Take up all the things. Listen, if there's ever a series, you need to listen to every sermon in the series. It's this one. Because if you get six and miss the seventh, you're in trouble. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. He's saying, because of everything I just said, therefore, because of everything I just said, take up the whole armor. The word take up is analambano, and it means to snatch up for your own use. It's in the aorist imperative tense in the Greek, which is a command given with military snap and curtness. Pick it up! You know, sometimes you need to teach your children to quit being so sensitive. Because the way they obey your voice is the way they'll obey God's voice. Honey, 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 would you please think about taking up that armor so the devil doesn't whip your hiney? Honey, sweetie pie, please, sweetie, sugar, sugar, don't go in the street because that truck gonna run over you. Please don't do that. Sugar pie. No, if they're going to, stop it! The armor's laying it, pick that up. Pick that up right now. I don't like how you pick it up. So Paul's being a general telling some soldiers, pick that up. Everybody doing all right? Grab the entire armor and use it for yourself all day, every day. Don't you ever set it down. Do you hear me? And he says, then he uses the word whole armor again, panoplia, all of it, so that you might be able to withstand. This is antihistemi or antistemi, which is the opposite of standing. So that's to stand against, to resist, to oppose. It's the opposite, as I said, of standing. This is also a military position. So when Cody and I were toe-to-toe, it would have been his. He was bowing down. He was digressing. But if he'd have bowed back up, that would be antihistemi. So that you may be able to stand against in the evil day. The word evil here is paneros. There's two Greek words for evil, kakos, paneros. One is evil in the generic sense. One is evil with an assignment against the good. Do you know that the devil has an assignment against your destiny? And just because God promised you something doesn't mean the devil's not going to give an assignment to those four categories of demons to stop it. There are days where the devil attacks you more than others. Just like there's kairos moments where God is moving and you must seize it, there are strategic moments when the devil's trying to kill you and get you to quit, and you better know how to antihistemi, stand against him. But watch this. You cannot wait until the day of attack to armor up. It's too late. That's why Paul's saying, take it up now, take it up now, put it on, put it on, put it on, get ready. Why? Because he knows it'll be too late. Then he says, having done all to stand. Literally, he's saying this. Having completed the task of standing against the attack, here's what I want you to do. Keep standing! Some of you go, would you quit yelling? Yeah, in about 10 minutes. See, before you can ever fight, you got to learn how to stand. Listen, everybody thinks they're a fighter. All the guys in here think you're a fighter. You think you're a fighter. Sometimes I just wish I had some standards. Stand. Strike a military position, and I'm going to stand. When the storms come, I stand. When The devil attacks, I stand. When I'm tempted to be offended, I stand against it. When sickness comes, I stand against it. When poverty tries to attack, I stand against it. When the nation is crumbling, I stand. When everybody around me is falling, I stand. When nothing seems right, I stand. When everybody's against me, I stand. Somebody say, stand. Now sit down, sit down, sit down. I'm not done. I told you to stand. Now sit down. Listen. There are too many Christians that can't stand. And I can't stand Christians that can't stand. You get in the picture? Before he mentions one piece of armor, he tells them why they need to armor up. Because there's a battle. And if you're going to be a fighter, you got to learn how to be a stander. You got to outlast some things. You have access to superhuman strength. Put all this on, baby, and you're indestructible. You're invincible. I'm so tired of Christians that when trouble comes, they fold like a cheap suitcase. Maybe I travel a lot and that means a lot to me. Have a suitcase, you go to pull it and the handle breaks off. I don't buy cheap luggage, I buy expensive luggage. God's looking for some Christians that are expensive luggage. They'll withstand when they're thrown in the hold and tromped on by TSA. And those baggage handlers, I think they jump up and down on your suitcases on purpose. I digress. But he's saying, I want you to stand, shoulders back, head held high, toe to toe with anything the devil throws at you. Then, and only then, he gets to verse 14. When you've completed the task of standing, stand some more. In other words, you're going to stand until you die. Stand therefore, having your waist girded with truth. The first piece of armor, and I gotta hurry, is the belt of truth, or the loin belt. Why did Paul begin with the description of a belt? Who cares? We have a couple of fashion majors, Jeanette and Ariana. Fashion design made. You know, I don't think when they come out on the runway, the first thing they say is, look at that belt. It's an amazing belt. The belt is incredible. They might get to it eventually. If it's a really cool belt, I'm sure they'll describe it in due time. But the first thing they don't mention is the belt. You can't even see mine. Because I don't tuck my shirt in very often. Belt is an accessory. It's not to most of us. These soldiers had bronze breastplates that shined in the sun. They were blinding. They had helmets that were ornate with bronze and all kinds of ornaments on them and this huge decoration, and the greater you went up, the greater the helmet. And so why didn't Paul start with the helmet or the breastplate or this amazing sword? No, he says, when you've done everything to stand, stand with your belt on. Nobody cares about the belt. There are two main reasons. I'm going to give them to you fast. Number one, the loin belt protected his ability to reproduce. We've highlighted the loin belt. Not only did it protect his ability to reproduce, it protected his most vulnerable assets. I'm not trying to be cute here. But I said the devil does not fight fair. We could bring Jason back up here and we could pick the smallest girl in this room. If she were able to get one blow in a strategic place, I don't care how big his muscles are, he will fold. He will quit standing. So Paul is saying, when you stand, have protection. Cover thyself. Because the devil is going to strategically attack you with a low blow. Everybody knows when you're fighting, it's off limits. Two dudes, you know, two guys are fighting. You don't hit a guy in the nads. Just, no. No, no, no. We're going to beat you up. The whole playground, third grade, you figured that out. You did that one time, and everybody beat you up. Said, no, you never do that again. Your daddy even spanked you. Said, don't you ever hit a boy there. Don't you do that. Not fair. But you're in a life or death battle. And the devil hits you anywhere he can. He knows your most vulnerable places. He knows where you're weak. He knows that you're subject to pornography, so he's going to make sure that that comes across your screen. So you got to have some protection. Is anybody here? He knows money's your weakness. He knows what yours is, and if he can hit you there, he can get you to stop standing. Not only are you most vulnerable there and you're growing, some of you go, I'm never going to forget this message. I may forget lots of messages. Listen, the devil trying to hit me in the groin. But also, if hitting you in the groin might not kill you, but it can stop your ability to reproduce. And God called you to be fruitful and multiply. So even if it doesn't kill you, it can stop your reproductive purpose. Render you spiritually sterile. Let that soak in for a second. We've all got weaknesses, places of vulnerability. Everyone's are different, but the devil knows where that is. And if you don't have your belt on, he's going for a low blow. So what is your belt? Truth. What is truth? Actually, truth is a person, and his name is Jesus. And he's the centerpiece of your armor. It's all about Jesus. Truth is personified in Jesus, but it can be discovered in the written word of God. And we'll get to the sword of the Spirit, but also truth is in the Word, because the Word of God is the truth that points to Jesus. So for us, we could say it this way. Truth covers and protects my most vulnerable places and my ability to reproduce spiritually. You can't cover your own weakness. You think, I'll grip my teeth and I'll stand strong. You can't do that alone. You need truth. In the wilderness, Jesus used truth. When the devil attacked him, he said, it is written. The devil attacks you with a lie in your most vulnerable place. And you got to learn how to speak truth. Otherwise, you're uncovered and you're open to attack. What's the second reason the belt is the most important piece of armor? All the other armor rests on this piece. You can see it in the photo. His sword, his lance, his breastplate, it's all connected. Without the belt of truth, his breastplate could come up and he would be vulnerable to a dagger in the heart. So he could be wearing it, but it's ineffective. He had to have something to, because he had a spear and a lance and a sword. He had to have something to carry them with, so his sword would be attached to it. His lance, his dagger would be attached to it. And even his spear would rest on it. So every piece of the armor rested on this piece. So we could say it this way. Truth is a foundational garment. Somebody come to the keyboard. Truth's a foundational garment. Let me talk about foundational garments. Some of you ain't old enough to know what I mean. My grandmother didn't talk about underwear. My grandmother talked about foundational garments. If you can call it a bra, she called it a foundational garment. She called it a girdle. She called it a foundational garment. Truth holds everything in place. Some of you still ain't getting this, or some of you going, is he really talking about that? Back in the day, foundational garments had some support. Now, girls just let it all hang out there. Just free to go. Some of you need some of that stuff back. My granny's girdle, it held it all together. Today it would be Spanx. Some people need some spiritual Spanx. You need a little undergarment. Quit being so free. I'm just free. Free. You need some truth to hold some stuff together. Somebody, you're never going to forget this message. You're never going to. Men or women, you ain't never going to forget it. I'm talking in code because not everybody's 21 in here now. Come on. Paul said everything in your life is going to rest on truth. The sword don't work. There's no truth. Peace don't work. There's no truth. Righteousness doesn't work without truth. Salvation doesn't work without truth. But then in 1 Timothy 3:15, Paul says, I'm going to tell you. He said, I can't get to you. So I'm going to write you a letter. And in the letter, I'm going to tell you how to act in church. We, you know, used to, there were church mothers, especially in the black church. Come on, anybody raised in the black church? Well, four of you, Freddie was. Come on, we got anybody raised in a black church? You had church mamas. Church mothers, they tell you you need to put on some foundational garments, honey. Church mothers tell you how to act in church. We don't do that anymore because that's religious. We don't want to be religious. It's free of Jesus. We might need a few church mothers. that can tell some folks, put all that stuff back in there, quit believing a lie and live by the truth. Paul said, I'm going to teach you how to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God. Watch this. The pillar and the ground of truth. So if truth is foundational to your fight against the devil, the church is foundational to you learning truth. It's the church of Jesus, so Jesus is truth, but you're not going to get all the truth by yourself. You're going to get it in the context. Now, good news, you're here. You're in church, so I'm telling you, you're in a good place, because in the day-to-day and connect group, and when you go to LTS, and when you come to Bible class, and when you come on Sunday morning, and when you get in relationship, people rub against you, and some people rub you the wrong way, and iron sharpens iron, but you start getting some foundations in all those lies where the devil said, you can't do it, you'll never make it. Somebody comes along and says, you can go where God says you can go. You can have what God says you can have. You can be what God says you can be. And you start getting grounded and rooted in the truth of God's word. And it becomes a pillar and a foundation that your life is built on. And no lie from the devil can get in your mouth. My God, I wish for 30 seconds somebody would thank God for truth. That's why you need local church. That's why we need one another. That's why we're here. Because God wants to ground us in truth so that everything can hang on it. Listen, I'm done. But watch this. Nobody notices your belt till you ain't got one. No, nobody cares about your belt till your pants fall down. We got a whole generation of boys need to put a belt on. Say no to the crack. Because if the devil gets you believing a lie, he can kill you. He can destroy you. He can steal from you.